الحمد لله خالق الوجود من الظلم ومخرج الصبر من الألم وملك التوبة على الندم ونشكره على مصائب كما نشكره على النعم ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم ذي الشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبي والخاتم سي ولد الآدم فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم فالحمد لله الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters أحييكم بتحية الإسلام تحية مباركة ألا وهي السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته So my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters We finish explaining verse number 13 in Surah Al-Kahf And Allah Ta'ala, after he finished summarizing the story in two or three verses Allah Ta'ala will now spend around two pages and a half to relate the story of Ashabul Kahf in detail. So the last verse that we touched on during our last Kahfi hour was نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ دَبَأَهُمْ بِالْحَقِّ إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ وَزِدْنَاهُمْ هُدَى We are the one narrating to you their news, their account. Indeed, they were youth who believe in their God and we increase their guidance. And we share the important points for this verse that we could benefit from is that when we show our sincerity to Allah Ta'ala, when we show our strong faith to Allah Ta'ala, our Iman, Allah Ta'ala will pave the way out for us. If we do something with the proper pure intention, Allah Ta'ala will put His blessings in it, His barakah to it. Okay, so my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, today we will start on verse number 14. So in verse number 14, Allah Ta'ala starts the story of Ashabul Kahf in detail. Allah Ta'ala says, وَرَبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ إِذْ قَامُوا فَقَالُوا رَبُّنَا رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ And we made firm their hearts when they stood up and said, Our Allah is the Lord of the heavens and earth. Okay, here the timeline is rewind back. Now the youngsters are standing in front of the king. The Quran did not explain explicitly that they were on trial. But we can understand from the context. So now they are standing in front of the king. And it's not easy for a young person to stand trial with the whole court looking at him. Obviously, to be in that position would be very terrifying. And Allah Ta'ala says, وَرَبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ Allah Ta'ala says, we put firmness in their hearts. This phrase is usually used in the Quran in emotional situations, where emotionally, if it wasn't there, we wouldn't be able to carry ourselves. The same phrase was used when Musa alayhi salam's mother placed him in the water. إِنْ كَانَتْ لَتُبْدِي بِهِ لَوْلَا أَرَّبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قَلْبِهَا She was about to disclose the matter concerning him, had we not made her heart firm. Because emotionally, if we were in their places, we won't be able to handle ourselves. We won't be able to hold it. We will have caved in a little. Here, the young men's hearts were fluttering and they needed to be calmed down. Hence, Allah Ta'ala gave them a strength of heart that they could not have possessed themselves. Allah tied up their hearts, made their hearts firm. Allah Ta'ala gave them strength in their hearts because they have strong faith. And also in this verse, it also shows us that blessings begin from within, then they manifest from outside. Allah Ta'ala protected them. Before the physical protection, there was an emotional protection. Before the protection of the cave, there is a protection of the heart. Before they are protected from the enemies, they need to be protected from themselves, from their wavering doubts. وَرَبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ إِذْ قَامُوا We made their hearts firm when they stood up. Here we see, when they showed Allah Ta'ala their determination, when they stood up, Allah Ta'ala helped them. Allah Ta'ala showered them His blessings. Allah Ta'ala made their hearts firm. And this too apply to us. Start from our side and Allah Ta'ala will continue the rest. Use the means of this world that Allah Ta'ala had provided us with. Then make dua and tawakkal to Allah. And then the continuation of the verse is لَن نَدْعُوَ مِن دُونِهِ إِلَهَ لَقَدْ قُلْنَا إِذًا شَطَطَى We will not worship anything except Allah Ta'ala. And if we were to do this, then we will have said something that is excessively wrong. MashaAllah. Look at the wisdom of their speech. These youngsters, They didn't point fingers and said, "You are wrong, you are at fault." But rather, they put the fault of the community upon themselves. They said hypothetically, if we were to believe in anything other than Allah, then we are in the wrong. They didn't point fingers and put accusations on others, but rather, they gave everyone food for thought. Because if these youngsters were accusative, "You are wrong, you are at fault, you don't understand," then who is going to listen? Who is going to listen to what we wish to say if we've accused them to be wrong? So from this portion of the verse, it shows wisdom in da'wah. Then in the next verse, Allah Ta'ala continues the story. هَٰؤُلَاءِ قَوْمٌ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً لَوْلَا يَأْتُونَ عَلَيْهِم بِسُلْطَانٍ بَيِّنٍ فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنِ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا. Those people of ours have taken beside Allah Ta'ala deities. Why do they not bring for worship of them a clear proof? And who is more unjust than one who invents about Allah Ta'ala a lie? In this verse, it tells us that every action, every word pertaining Allah Ta'ala, pertaining the religion, has to be with sound evidence. Our religion is based on evidence. And at the end of the verse, Allah Ta'ala highlighted, فَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنِ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا. And who is more unjust than one who invents about Allah Ta'ala a lie? This portion of the verse is what we discussed in our previous session, that it is a sin to speak about the religion and to speak about Allah Ta'ala without knowledge. And here, Allah Ta'ala stresses it again. So my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, be careful. Be careful of what we say about Allah Ta'ala and the religion of Allah Ta'ala. Because our speeches are monitored by Allah Ta'ala, every single word of it. So imagine what Allah Ta'ala will feel if we speak about Allah Ta'ala without being 100% sure of it. Oh yeah, and before I forget, the starting of this verse, هَٰؤُلَاءِ قَوْمُنَا, they are our people. Here it shows that they were concerned about their people, even though they have their differences, but they are still concerned for the community. This is Islam. Then in the next verse, Allah Ta'ala continues, وَإِذِ اعْتَزَلْتُمُوهُمْ وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ فَأْوُوا إِلَى الْكَهْفِ يَنْشُرْ لَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ وَيُهَيِّئْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَمْرِكُمْ مِرْفَقًا. The youth said to one another, "And when you have withdrawn from them and that which they worship other than Allah, retreat to the Kahf. Your Lord will spread out for you of His mercy and will prepare for you from your affair facility." People usually use this verse as an excuse to break away from the community. But no, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, even Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam did remain in Mecca for 13 years despite all the difficulties and persecution. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam still remained. So is it better to remain in a community of misguidance, or is it better to break away? Majority of scholars have said that the general ruling is we must remain in our community as long as we bring benefit to the community. But when the situation changes and our religion is being threatened and we are not allowed to worship Allah Ta'ala properly, in this case, then it is preferable to save our religion. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam remained in Mecca for 13 years, even though he was persecuted, even though he was tortured, but he remained there as long as he was able to preach his message. Then when the Quraysh started plotting to kill our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, remember the assassination attempt that happened during the night the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was about to do hijrah to Medina? So when it gets to that level, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam flee and saved his religion sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this was what this youth, the Ashabul Kahf, did. They made hijrah, they flee. Fa'wu ila al-kahf يَنْشُرْ لَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ وَيُهَيِّئْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَمْرِكُمْ مِرْفَقًا. Retreat to the cave. Allah Ta'ala will spread out for you His mercy and will prepare for you from your affair facility. From this portion of this verse, it shows us a simple Islamic principle. إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Never does Allah Ta'ala reveal a hardship except that He revealed it. Never does Allah Ta'ala test you except that He will also bless you. With every testing, there is a blessing. In every fitnah, there is a way out. And every adab, there is also rahmah. These young men were tortured by their people. They had to flee. According to an interpretation, each one of them was sons of the nobleman. So they were of the elite of the society. But they broke off to save their religion and flee to the cave. They gave all up for Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala blessed them with much more. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا For indeed with hardship will be ease. Indeed with hardship will be ease. Then in the next verse it tells us that they are in the cave. وَتَرَى الشَّمْسَ إِذَا طَلَعَتْ تَزَاوَرُ عَنْ كَهْفِهِمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينِ وَإِذَا غَرَبَتْ تَقْرِضُهُمْ ذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ وَهُمْ فِي فَجْوَةٍ مِّنْ And had you been present, you will see the sun when it rose inclining away from their cave on the right, and when it set passing away from them on the left, while they were lying within an open space. So now they are in the cave. And in these next few verses, it shows the miracles of Allah Ta'ala. وَتَرَى الشَّمْسِ And you see the sun. Visualize the sun. It reflects its sunlight into the cave, but it is not heating them exactly, but at the same time giving them heat and freshen up the interior. So even the spots where they fell asleep were also decided by Allah Ta'ala. And these were among the miraculous signs of Allah Ta'ala. ذَلِكَ مِنْ آيَاتِ اللَّهِ مَنْ يَهْدِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ الْمُهْتَدِ وَمَنْ يُضْلِلْ فَلَنْ تَجِدَ لَهُ وَلِيًّا مُرْشِدًا That were the signs from Allah Ta'ala. He whom Allah Ta'ala guides is the rightly guided. But he whom Allah Ta'ala leaves astray, then none is able to guide them. Then Allah Ta'ala says in the next verse, وَتَحْسَبُهُمْ أَيْقَاظًا وَهُمْ رُقُودٌ And if there is a possibility that you came into the cave, you will think that they were all sitting up awake. وَهُمْ رُقُودٌ But they are in a light, enjoyable sleep. Rukud meant here, is not the sleep after an exhausting day. But rukud here means a nice, peaceful sleep. You know, like the sleep during khutbah Jum'ah, when as soon as the khatib gets on the mimbar and people start nodding away, then waking up feeling so fresh. Yeah, so that is rukud. وَنْقَلِّبُهُمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينَ وَذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ And we turn them to the right and to the left. This scenario is like paralyzed patient. They can't move on their own. And at the same time, they can't stay in a position too long because it may disrupt the blood flow. So they are being moved on one side, then to the other side. Allah Ta'ala is literally making sure that they won't wake up after 300 plus years with aches all over their body. Allah Ta'ala is taking care of these youngsters. Allah Ta'ala is taking care of them, even in their sleep. Just as Allah Ta'ala is taking care of us, taking care of the well-being of our bodies when we are asleep. Subhanallah, such is the grace of Allah Ta'ala. Then came the story about their dog. وَكَلْبُهُمْ بَاسِطُوا ذِرَاعَيْهِ بِالْوَصِيدِ While their dog stretched his forelegs at the entrance. Before I continue, some people might feel uneasy when talking about dogs, with an excuse that they are haram in Islam, as same goes to pigs. My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, they too are creations among the many creations that Allah Ta'ala had created. Yes, Islam places a few restrictions with regards to them, but it doesn't mean we have to look at them as if we want them to go extinct. Islam doesn't hate pigs, we just don't eat them. Allah Ta'ala did not command us to hate them. They are creations of Allah Ta'ala. Just because Islam prohibits us from eating them, doesn't mean we have to hate them. We can't eat lions, but nobody look at lions with hatred. So the same applies to other creatures. Okay, going back to the verse. So this verse tells us the conditions of everything that were placed, so precise that nobody in that 300 plus years will ever cross their mind to take a peek into the cave. What were those conditions specifically planned by Allah Ta'ala for them? Firstly, وَتَحْسَبُهُمْ أَيْقَاظًا وَهُمْ رُقُودٌ They didn't look like they were sleeping. Secondly, there's the dog. وَكَلْبُهُمْ بَاسِطُوا ذِرَاعَيْهِ That stretches out his two paws under the sun. And the third condition that played the role was the mouth of the cave. The mouth of the cave? What's wrong with the mouth of the cave? If you look at the verse, Allah Ta'ala used the word الوصيد, which means closing. أوصد الباب أغلقه So it is a very small opening. So much so that everybody will think rocks have fallen on that opening. So it doesn't look like an opening. It looks as if the cave is closed off. So even the appearance of the cave is meant to pull the curiosity away from others. But if, with a big if there is a person who has a mind full of curiosity, who happens to enter the cave and then pass the dog, then what will happen? Allah Ta'ala then explains, لَوِ اطَّلَعْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ لَوَلَّيْتَ مِنْهُمْ فِرَارًا وَلَمُلِئْتَ مِنْهُمْ رُعْبًا If you had looked at them, you would have turned from them in flight and been filled by terror because of them. Look how precise Allah Ta'ala took care of those youngsters. Allah Ta'ala took care of those youngsters' affairs. As how they took care of their faith, their religion, Allah Ta'ala took care of their affairs. MashaAllah. Then in the next verse, they woke up. وَكَذَلِكَ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ لِيَتَسَاءَلُوا بَيْنَهُمْ. And similarly, in that situation, we awaken them that they might question one another. قَالَ قَائِلٌ مِّنْهُمْ كَمْ لَبِثْتُمْ قَالُوا لَبِثْنَا يَوْمًا أَوْ بَعْضَ يَوْمٍ. Said a speaker from among them, how long have you remained here? They say, we have remained a day or part of a day. So this is the first group. Then another group said, قَالُوا رَبُّكُمْ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا لَبِثْتُمْ. They said, your Lord is most knowing of how long you've remained. And that settles it. Over here, they didn't get 2 days, nor hours, nor minutes. All they said was, Allah Ta'ala knows better. My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, Allah Ta'ala is teaching us here that there are some things, some questions whose answers are not worth attempting. Questions that will not benefit us. We will not be a better believer if we have the exact answers. And all that we need to do for those types of questions is learn to say, Allah Ta'ala knows better, and leave it alone. Otherwise, it will distract us from things that are much more important. We have to learn to ask the right kind of questions. Then the story continues. فَبَعَثُوا أَهَدَكُمْ بِوَرِكِكُمْ هَذِهِ إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ. So send one of you with these silver coins of yours to the city. A day, or half a day, or 2 days. They don't really bother. They were hungry. So they decided between themselves to send someone to get some food. فَلْيَنْظُرْ. And let him look. Let him watch out. Watch out for what? Police. We will think because they were fugitives, so first thing they will remind each other is to watch out from being caught by the authorities. But no, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters. فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَيُّهَا أَزْكَى طَعَامًا. And let him look to which is the pure of food. Before telling about being careful of the police, they were more concerned of halal food. MashaAllah. Because pure food has a very important relationship to answering our du'as. Pure food shows how we care about Allah Ta'ala. Pure rizq is a real sign of taqwa. Because when we monitor what we eat, monitor what we are eating, and when we monitor what our money, where our money comes from, this really shows our level of iman and taqwa. And here, we have the youngsters who are trapped in the cave. We will think that the last thing they will be on these youngsters' mind will be what type of food they will be eating. But no. It shows that they are concerned about what enters their body and affect their iman. They are concerned of their iman. Subhanallah. Then there is a second advice. فَلْيَأْتِكُمْ بِرِزْقٍ مِّنْهِ. Then whoever that is appointed should bring some provisions from it. Meaning, don't bring back all the food that you see. Find pure food, then bring back part of it back. Bring part of the food that you find and don't bring back all the food that you see. Just because they were hungry, they didn't spend excessively. They didn't overbought their food. They didn't overspend. MashaAllah. But today, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, when we fast in Ramadan, our iftar, our breaking fast, will be a whole buffet. Appetizers, main course, side dishes, desserts, drinks. Allahu Akbar. May Allah Ta'ala forgive all our shortcomings, done intentionally or unintentionally. Ameen. Ya Rabbal Alameen. Then at the end of this verse come the reminder to be cautious. وَلْيَتَلَطَّفْ. Act normal. Blend in. Be careful. Look out for your surroundings. وَلَا يُشْعِرَنَّ بِكُمْ أَحَدًا. Nobody should realize or come to be aware of who you actually are. Because then they will all bear the consequences. And the next verse talks about the consequences. إِنَّهُمْ إِن يَظْهَرُوا عَلَيْكُمْ يَرْجُمُوكُمْ أَوْ يُعِيدُوكُمْ فِي مِلَّتِهِمْ وَلَنْ تُفْلِهُوا إِذًا أَبَدًا. Indeed, if they come to know of you, they will stone you or return you to their religion. And then never will you ever succeed. So up till here, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, these youngsters have clearly demonstrated their iman. They have fled for their safety. They have sought protection in the cave. They clearly have tawakkal in Allah Ta'ala. But their tawakkal doesn't mean that they should act foolishly. No. In this story, they reminded each other, وَلْيَتَلَطَّفْ Act discreetly. وَلَا يُشْعِرَنَّ بِكُمْ أَحَدًا Make sure nobody notices you. Don't draw attention to yourself. So here we can see that a mu'min is brave. And at the same time, a mu'min does not act foolishly. A mu'min has tawakkul. And a mu'min also takes precautions. Okay, we'll stop at this verse. Insha'Allah, in the next session, we will share how they were discovered. Allah Ta'ala says, وَكَذَلِكَ أَعْثَرْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ And that is how we made them sleep. Insha'Allah, we'll go in detail during our next Kahfi hour. May we gain benefit from what we've heard today, practice on it, and convey it to others as well. Whatever that is good comes from the blessing of Allah Ta'ala. I apologize for any shortcomings from myself. We close our session today with tasbih kafara. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.